Otherwise, the course will have two parts, as Noe said. The first part will contain a list of introductory lectures. I will talk about the physics of sound, so this will take off where Noe just left. And then there will be lectures, introduction to music and harmony, introduction to information theory, and introduction to what the brain is, or what the auditory brain is. And then in the second part of the course, there will be lectures about specifically about expectation and surprise. Okay, and Tali will present the general theory. I will talk about them in the brain. Ronnie will talk about expectation and surprise in music. This is a guest lecture of Sipat Foot on the motor system, and then now we will talk about expectation surprise in the actual doing of music, and Naftali Wagner will have a guest lecture on expectation surprise in harmonic analysis of music. And the last lecture will probably have the same format as this one. So this is one thing. This table will be in the will be in the website, as Noe mentioned. So here's my take about music and the brain. Okay, there are two types of questions we can ask. As Ronnie said, one of them is whether it's possible to, whether it's useful to understand the brain in order to understand music. Now that's a very big question. This is a better one. Okay, whether some understanding of the brain helps us to understand some facets of music, and Ronnie mentioned it in the context of knowing something about the constraints of the sensory system. Okay, but for me, the more interesting question is actually the opposite one, the question of whether music could help us to understand the brain. And this is because of, as Ronnie and Tali and Noe said, music as organization and the brain like organization. Okay, now, since my role in the course is to present the brain, we should first of all specify which brain we are talking about. So the obvious answer, and the one that I will emphasize, is the sensory brain, for example the auditory system. And one thing I'll try to convey to you is the auditory system is almost irrelevant for understanding music. Okay, the motor brain, I'm being facetious. The motor brain, so this is important for music performance. Foot will talk about it and Noe also. But in fact, I would say that there's a strong case to make about the motor brain involved also in music perception. One obvious aspect of music that's not dealt at all by the auditory system as we understand it now is rhythm, for example. Okay, so rhythm is very subjective to the independent auditory brain. And on the other hand, it's in the range of things that happen in the motor system, obviously, that's done. This leads us to the issue of perception, action loop in music perception. And there's also the emotional brain. These are different bits, or mostly different bits of brain. And they may be important for music perception and will be completely ignored in this lecture, or almost completely ignored in this course. Okay, so if we go to the auditory system, which is my specialty, we face actually a severe problem. Okay, when Ronnie mentioned the cognitive constraints on the perception of music, then she, for example, spoke about octave. Okay, the octave equivalence. Notes that are octave apart are, in a way, almost the same. Okay, there are other concepts here, musical scales, consonance and dissonance, okay, voice leading, how to create a polyphonic music for voices where you can actually follow different voices. Okay, so these are concepts that come from musicology, very naturally. And here are concepts that come from studying the auditory system. We have organization by frequency, we have places, different places in the brain, for example, a place called the anterior colliculus, you don't have to know it. Okay, we have things called with complicated names like peripheral excitation patterns or modulation spectra. It's not for nothing that you don't know these terms. These terms do not correspond to anything that you actually introspectively feel about sound. Okay, the auditory system, as we study it, is very far from the perceptual qualities of the, that we introspectively associate with sound. Now, there are attempts to make connections between the two levels. For example, octave equivalence will be related, I'll talk about it when I talk about the physics of sound, with the so-called peripheral excitation pattern. Okay, the first thing that's happening in the brain looks a little bit like the spectrogram that Nori showed you, and octaves play an important role there. Okay, or consonance and dissonance are related to something called modulation spectra. However, I find many of these correspondences a bit artificial because I lack good words to convey my meaning. There are no tones in the ear. There are no individual sounds that, I mean, you hear a violin and a cello, you hear the finger and the string quartet. Okay, these things do not exist at the ear. Okay, what you have at the ear is a mess. Okay, here's what you have at the ear. It's a waveform that vibrates the eardrum. Okay, now, can you tell me what, how this sounds? No. Okay, so let me play it for you. Okay, what was it? How many people? Men, women?
Men and women.
There's at least one woman there. Okay, so something happened. Sally spoke about the magic of seeing a lot of gray pixels and falling on the retina and seeing a dog. Okay, here's the same thing in the auditory modality. You have something that vibrates, a single thing that vibrates your eardrum, and within it you have five people laughing and maybe one woman, maybe a few men. Okay, now here's the spectrogram. Okay, from this mess it's very difficult to see anything, but also when you look at it as a spectrogram, it's still a mess. Okay, there are people who know how to read spectrograms, and when they see spectrogram speech, will tell you what the speech was. Okay, this is uninterpretable. I wanted to explain what a spectrogram is, but I skipped that. Okay, so what does the auditory system do? It deals with sounds, where sound, my definition here of sound is the sequence of pressures that the eardrum. And you have only two of these. There's a single sound at each ear. And out of that, you synthesize, okay, the musical intervals, the instruments, the voices, and so on and so forth. Okay, so musicologists, when we talk about music, musicologists deal with high-level constructs, not with the sound in this sense, not with the physical stimulus that gets to our ears. Now, it turns out, okay, and this is the reason that we talk together, that there is a level of concept, not the standard one, not octave equivalence or consonance and dissonance, but a level of a set of concepts that are encoded, that we can see in the electrical activity in the brain, that are very important for music, but they are not these simple-minded equivalences. They are related precisely to the issues of change detection, deviance detection, surprise, and so on. So in a sense, when we look at the auditory system, and only show the definition of sound as of music as organized sound with something, so I will keep the organized sound. Okay, in a way, the organization appears first and only later the sound comes. Okay, the auditory system is more sensitive to, every auditory system is more, encodes more the organization than the sound. Okay, and for lack of time, I keep it. This was my cow and the Dalmatian dog.
No, it's actually
not. Okay. Did you understand the speech? Okay, so this is the auditory version of these pictures that I have a lot of gray and white and black things. Okay, and I'm putting in more and more details. Can you understand the speech now? Not yet. Can you understand the speech now? Not yet. Now? Oh, now something popped out. I'll play it again.
The farmer keeps a bull.
Okay, here's the original.
The farmer keeps a bull. The farmer keeps a bull.
Okay, now you heard it. Okay, also here.
The kettle's quite hot. The kettle's quite hot.
Okay, so this happens here in the auditory system. Tali showed the slides, like I also had to show it, but we'll go over it in the next lesson, in a future talk. And in my role of in the course, I try to explain to you what sounds are, okay, and then we talk about how auditory system represents sound in the physical structure of sound, and from there, okay, we'll go into this claim that expectation and surprise are actually represented first, and only later the sounds are created. Okay, that's it.
No, 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 no,